Welcome back to Ion Foxborough. I'm Karen Guregian. Today, I'm pleased to welcome back three-time Super Bowl champion Ted Johnson, who is currently co-hosting the Rich Shurtleff show on WZLX. Hello, Ted.
Hey Karen, how you doing today?
Well, I'm doing good.
Good.
The Patriots are 1-5, but they might have found a quarterback.
That's
what were
cool.
your impressions of Drake?
Yeah, I was pleasantly surprised. I really was. I wasn't sure what I was gonna see. I was anticipating an uglier performance than that, but he pleasantly surprised me, Karen. Obviously, the things that kind of jump out really for me were, his poise, his what I it looked to me as if he was in control. I didn't see him panic too much. What I really liked was his ability to, read defenses. There was a couple plays, particularly that play, that touchdown pass right before halftime to Kayshon Booty. That was just a nice read on his part to kind of see press man coverage out there and that there was not a safety over the top to help him. That was a good read on his part. And then just obviously some nice throws. I thought that was a beautiful pass to Kayshon, which was great. So, he showed off his accuracy. Now I know he sailed one early. But that's to be expected for a kid in his position. But just his ability to escape, make plays with his feet, and just some of the decision making, I thought was really good. So I come away from that game feeling optimistic about that position, about what the future looks like at that position in particular. So he showed off a little bit of athleticism, I thought, running the football. I mean, man, he is fast. I didn't realize how fast. And the times he did pull the ball down, I thought were good decisions. And I thought when he was in the open field that he wasn't too cavalier about it. He knew when he needed to get down, knew when he needed to get it out of bounds. And I thought that was also pretty good to see. So overall, I really liked what I saw from the rookie quarterback.
I think some of the things that they were kind of protecting against, guarding against, him understanding what he's seeing in front of him. And I thought he was actually particularly good picking up the blitz, and kind of knowing how to, what he needed to do each time he saw it coming. I mean, he completed pass, he'd roll out, complete, just that, recognition, I thought, for him, for a rookie, was pretty impressive.
Yeah, and that's what we were told that he was picking up in practice, right? And so, if in practice, I would show Drake Maye a lot of different types of blitzes to see how he handled it. The blitzes that he's going to see in the NFL are way more complex than you'd ever see in college. The spread offense kind of it neutralizes a lot of defenses and forces them to be a little bit more predictable and less disguising. And so, but in the NFL game, they can hit you with advanced blitzing, even though you are going to run the spread. And you're right. I thought he handled it pretty good. The offensive line, maybe not so much, but you're right. And that's what you're going to see. That's what you saw teams do to Jacoby Brissett early in the season. And you saw each team they played as the weeks went on up their blitzing packages against the Patriots because I think Jacoby was having trouble with particularly the offensive line. So, pretty interesting that in Drake Maye's first start in week six that they'd have the lowest pressure rate of any game that they played so far this season. So, and it was with his first start. So that bodes well, obviously, with for him and this team going down the road this year.
How much of a boost do you think he gives the franchise? I mean, obviously we're seeing empty seats at Gillette. We've seen fan unrest, fan apathy. I wrote that, he's at least brought some interest back. People are now going to be curious to watch him week after week after week, and see how he progresses. Or, do we really have the guy? So he's, at the very least, he's piqued curiosity. Do you agree?
Without a doubt, Karen. I mean, you look at, and I used to tell this story to people all the time, and it's sometimes it's hard for people to kind of get their head around. But I would tell people, when I played with Brady, and he made me a better player playing with him. He made our defense a better defensive unit because he was our quarterback. And so, well, how can a quarterback who plays on offense affect what you do on defense? And I said, he gives you a psychological advantage knowing that he's your quarterback. If your defense knows that if you get the ball back, you have a quarterback capable of scoring and winning you a game, it's going to make everybody play just a little bit harder. And that's the difference a lot of times in winning and losing, making them play, getting off the field. It is just if everyone believes that you have a quarterback that can win you a football game, it raises the collective effort, in my opinion. And so you're going to see that, I think, a little bit in this team. That's if you listen to the wide receivers talk about Drake Maye after this game, and even the defensive players. I mean, we're going to run through a wall for him. I love the kid. He's got moxie. He's a natural born leader, I think I heard Kendrick Bourne say. Those guys, if they genuinely feel that way, which I imagine they do, they're going to run just a little bit harder on their route. They're going to study just a little bit more. They're going to just do the things that little things that add up to wins in this league. And so you're gosh darn right to think that Drake Maye is going to probably improve the overall play of the team just because of his ability and his leadership style. Guys are going to believe in him, and it's going to raise the collective effort for sure. And I just don't know how you don't kind of get caught up in the vortex of Drake Maye if you're a fan of the team and watching. And now I think curiosities are going to be peaked. People are going to want to watch maybe when they were really kind of checked out at this point. I think they're going to check back in because they're going to want to see what this young kid can do.
I think it's such an important quality for a quarterback to have, their ability to elevate the people around them. I think we saw that with the offense. The defense didn't have the best game. They were put in some tough positions, but Jacoby was Jacoby, but he didn't make anyone around him better or want to, elevate. But I mean, gosh, now you see guys chomping at the bit, the receivers thinking he's gonna hit them, down the field, which is something that wasn't happening before.
And that specifically is obviously an element that's been missing in this offense this year, and really an element that's been missing in this offense for
Quite a
several years.
while. Yeah.
And look, the Patriots clearly, obviously, want to be a run team, ball control team. But the only if you want to win football games, you have to have a deep threat element to your team. You have to have a big play type of element in your game, or else teams are just going to load up the box and dare you to throw, and it's going to be very, very hard to run against a lot of fronts and do the quick passing game when they're all loaded in the box knowing that you don't have a deep threat. So I just think now you watch the tape. You got the Jacksonville Jaguars this weekend. They're going to be watching the tape. They're going to say, oh man, there's what, three plays of 30 or more yards. There's an explosive element. There's a deep threat element. We might have to play with two safeties deep, and that all of a sudden now you're checking into runs, and you're getting better production on first down, and hopefully making those third down plays a little bit shorter than they were this past weekend. So just opening up the offense, there's a trickle-down effect to your entire offense that a lot of people don't realize, but that'll be part of it.
Talking about the two safeties look that they got against the Texans. Early on, the previous games, teams were getting away with one safety, I believe, because they just didn't feel that they would be threatened down the field. And that
Yep.
allowed them to kind of clog up the middle a little more. If Drake's presence and his just the threat of him throwing downfield gives makes them play two safeties deep, guess what's open? The middle of the field, right?
Wow, Karen. Oh my gosh, you're warming my heart when you say that, because that is absolutely right. You're dead on. That's the weakness in cover two is always the middle of the field. That's where you're most vulnerable. And so if and that's you want that middle of the field to be your property for an offense. That's the easiest throw to make for a quarterback, right? Between the numbers and between the hashes. And so if you can have production and make hay over the middle of the field, the DeMario Douglas touchdown. It's a lot easier to move the ball downfield and score points. And so you're absolutely right. It's very advantageous to have, a passing game and a deep threat to get that cover two look. And then you can kind of go to work, in the middle of the field where you have capable players. I think, Hunter Henry, besides him, Austin Hooper, but obviously DeMario Douglas. That's where they're going to make their money is in the middle of the field. And so you're absolutely right. That's another kind of benefit of being able to throw the deep ball is that you loosen up things in the middle of the field because more teams are going to be playing two safeties deep. And so that now you have to go take advantage of that.
Speaking of DeMario, it seemed pretty obvious he's Drake's favorite target. He's their best receiver. He's a guy that can get open against man coverage. And yet, he doesn't see quite as many snaps as a Booty and some other guys. And I think the reason for that is, they've had success with 12 personnel, two tight end sets, and that takes DeMario off the field. You think they need to tinker with that a little bit to get him on the field?
Probably so. Probably so. And they were really having success running the football out of 12. That was their kind of, that was where they were really getting a lot of their production on the ground was when they had two tight ends there. Well, look, you are as much as you want to be this, ball control, hold the ball, run the ball, grind it out. I think you're having some issues, not only pass protecting with your offensive line, but I think run blocking. So we talk, we usually focus on the inexperienced offensive line being an issue when it comes to protecting the passer. But I think you're starting to see kind of the turnover with the offensive line starting to affect the run game. That, and then also the fact that you were really seeing a quarterback that's more comfortable in the shotgun as opposed to Jacoby Brissett, who was mostly under center. Now you're shifting to a shotgun quarterback, and it's a little bit harder to run the football. In shotgun, at least there's the timing's a little bit different, and I think there's more challenges. And so, but when you're in spread offense shotgun like Drake Maye is, it just makes more sense to have another receiver out there as opposed to just two in the 12 personnel. Now you have three in 11 personnel. My feeling is you're going to see an uptick in 11 personnel, which is one tight end, three wide receivers, one running back. Because of the fact that it's a better operation versus the spread, and when you have a quarterback that's in shotgun, I just think I think it's a little bit more of a wasted personnel group to have 12 out there when you really need really that third wide receiver. So I'm expecting DeMario Douglas to get more snaps as the season goes on, Karen.
What's your confidence level in Alex Van Pelt? Obviously Drake looked ready, fairly ready to go. So the people working with him, AVP, McCartney, Ben McAdoo, looks like they did a pretty good job getting him ready for the moment. What's your confidence level that AVP, as he's known, can dial up an offense that's more conducive to Drake Maye?
Well, it's not high, and I feel bad because he seems like a really good guy. He does. It's been a rough start for him, particularly in a market that I just don't think maybe appreciates his leadership style. AVP is your kind of your quintessential coach, and he's that good old boy, and he talks plainly, and in a way, I think some people can turn people off here. So he's it's a tough road for him, and I would say I question whether or not he can be the guy to kind of help mold Drake Maye, because he has one style of offense he likes to run. That's the West Coast offense. It is not the offense that Drake Maye ran in North Carolina, which is really, I think we're all learning, Karen, that most smart teams, they build an offense around the quarterback that they're most comfortable with. And it's kind of funny. It used to be there was a time in which the NFL game trickled down to the college game. And now it's really the other way around. I feel like it's the college game is really impacting how offenses are run in the NFL, because teams lose patience with these young quarterbacks, and they say, you know what, let's just do what they're comfortable doing from their high school years, and start implementing more college concepts. And so, can AVP adapt with that? Can he change what he's been doing his whole career to make the quarterback a little bit more comfortable in what he's used to? And that remains to be seen. I'm a little bit worried that he can pull that off. Just what I saw from his system for the first five games through Jacoby Brissett, I've been a little bit concerned, just some of the thinking behind some of the play calling in certain situations in the game. Obviously, you've been probably talking to death all the clock management issues, and this just the strategy, how to start games, how to start drives, how to finish off the end of halves has been a big question mark. And I've questioned some of the route concepts. I'd like to see more game planning, if you will, to get guys open more in the middle. And I just haven't seen that. So I'm a little bit skeptical, but I'm willing to give them the benefit of the doubt and see where it goes. The first game was pretty good. I didn't like how the game started out. I didn't like some of the play calling. And then as the game went on, I felt like Alex adjusted kind of his strategy, and I think he started kind of calling plays that were a little bit more suited for this offense of Drake Maye. So we'll see. Hopefully you'll see an improvement in his play calling as the season goes on with Drake now.
Yeah, he let Drake cook a little bit, but I think part of that too was the score in the game. He couldn't just let him play conservative and hand the ball off, hand the ball off, and hand the ball off. The running game went nowhere. So,
And Karen, I think there's also it's Alex Van Pelt, but I think it's also you also got to know what is the true nature of your quarterback. And I don't know. I think the nature of Drake Maye is probably a little bit more of an aggressive mindset than the incumbent, Jacoby Brissett, who I think his nature was to play a more conservative game and not. And I'll give you an example. So right before halftime, that touchdown pass to Kayshawn Booty, there was two timeouts. They were on the Texans 40-yard
40.
line. So they were in field goal range already before he threw that touchdown pass. But there were 16 seconds, two timeouts on the Texans 40. He had a chance to take a shorter completion to DeMario Douglas, who was wide open over the middle, and maybe just get in the field goal range, call a timeout, and kick your field goal and go in at halftime. But instead, he threw it downfield, and they got a touchdown. So if Jacoby's in there, I think he takes the shorter route and gets the guaranteed points, as opposed to Drake Maye's like, I'm going to take a shot down the field, and it benefited him. So I think there's a difference in personalities in the two quarterbacks, and so that should help get the ball down the field more too.
watching them against the Texans in particular, just seeing CJ Stroud and kind of seeing the team that Nick Sirianni built around him. It's almost like he built the team, then he got the quarterback.
That's he did. Exactly right.
You look at their offensive line that features like three first round draft picks. Okay. I don't think they have anything. They're all draft picks. And you look at the Patriots line and you got a bunch of waiver claims, basically. You have Mike Onwenu, and then you have, with David out now, a bunch of undrafted waiver claim types protecting the franchise. It boggles my mind a little bit, and I know, they inherited it in a way, but I don't know. They really have to do something next year. I mean, it's a done deal now. You can't do much now. But I mean, does it surprise you that they didn't have a little more of an emphasis on a left tackle, prior to the season even starting?
It's amazing, absolutely amazing, and I just can't. I just, can't, I don't know what it is. I just there's two things, and if I was ever to be a head coach of a football team, there's two things that I would, that would be the first two things I would think about. And look, everybody's different, and I'm just saying that my thinking is right. But I just, it's I've been around football my whole life, and this in my gut, it just feels like the first thing I would want is to know who my coaches were going to be. And I would target certain coaches because I would want to know exactly, I already have predetermined what my offensive system is going to be and what my defensive system is going to be. And I'm going to hire coaches that best coach that. That's going to be my number one thing. Then my number two thing is I'm going to build an offensive line that is going to be tough and nasty and physical and set the tone for the entire team. I have said this my entire career. If you were to go back, I'm sure I said the quote to you when I was playing many, many years ago, that to me, the offensive line is the most important unit on a football team. Just the their collective disposition, their attitude, they have a protective mindset. The franchise is in their hands, right? They're blocked, and the way they play, because your offensive line is, it's like a microcosm of how football works. It's, you are as strong as your weakest link in the offensive line. And so it's just an incredibly important position and unit to address and to make sure you have elite players, tough players, character players at those positions and on that unit. And it boggles my mind, just like you said, that there is not a more emphasis put on that position unit than there is, particularly with this team. I don't get it. Particularly when you have a young quarterback that's still green, you want to make sure you protect them. And if you talk about what the Texans have done, Karen, I told my buddy, I was texting. I need to reach out to my man, the General John McClain, and tell him my thoughts. But I was talking to a buddy of mine who does a morning show down there on Sports Radio 610 the Sunday night after the game. I'm rewatching the game, and I'm falling in love with that team. CJ Stroud is a cyborg, Karen. He is a super freak. Some of the throws he was making, I was impressed with the Texans' passing game. Everybody wants to talk about their running game, but just the explosive players they have everywhere. They have, it's elite athletes on both sides of the ball, a great offensive line to protect, an incredible wide receiver. I mean, excuse me, quarterback who's throwing incredible wide receivers, who's got a great running back who's a backup, Joe Mixon. With a complimentary tight end. So you want, I told my buddy Sean, it's so funny how when I was doing radio down in Houston for 8 years, all we talk about is how the Texans need to be more like the Patriots. Well, shoot, now it's tables flipped. I want the Patriots to be more like the Texans because they built one hell of a football team down there.
Kudos to Nick. And
Yep.
we had John McClain on last week, and he was saying the very, very same thing. So let's flip to the Patriots defense before we go. Let's see. I don't see much of a pass rush. I still don't see the edge being set. I'm still seeing breakdowns. I'm still seeing poor tackling, and I'm still seeing big plays galore. I know they've had some injuries to players in key positions, but it just looks disheveled to me,
Yeah.
watching them. What do you make of that?
Hugely disappointing. I thought the preseason hype fervor over that defense was a little overrated. I thought they were a good defense. I thought they were, a top 12 defense. That never did I ever think that they were, even with, I'll be honest, even with Barmore and Jabril Peppers, if he was out there. And Juwan Bentley, I still thought it was going to be, top 10, top 12 defense. But even with those guys missing, I'm still kind of surprised how bad they are. And really, the biggest kind of concerns for me is really lack of pass rush. But it's kind of expected when you the players that you have out there, they're more about the Patriots defense. Is more about and has been, at least in the last, several years here, even under Bill Belichick, is more about the scheme than it is about the individual player. Like for instance, the Texans have Willie Anderson, who, if you look at all his sacks, were any of those sacks? Well, I don't want to quiz you in case you haven't, rewatched it, but all his sacks, Karen, were he was single blocked. He just beat his man to get to the quarterback, where the Patriots do scheming and they do stunts and they do two and three man, twists to get guys open, to get sacks. They don't have one guy that can just, beat a double team or beat a block. They have to scheme it up. It's more about they kind of, and I've always thought there's a little bit of an arrogance to how they approach defense there. And it's still, I still see elements of that when I see. It's almost like the defensive staff wants to show that they're smarter than everybody, and they disguise and they scheme and they game plan, as opposed to just kind of keeping it simple and not having guys playing all these multiple positions where I think you get in trouble. So what I'm seeing is a lot of guys playing different positions that are out of position at times because, one series they're playing on the right side, and the next series they're playing on the left side. One series they're playing regular cover two, and on the next series they're playing an inverted cover two. And teams are really kind of taking advantage of that by running a lot of empty sets, by doing some hurry up offense that confuses the Patriots defense because they have so many guys rotating in and out and playing multiple positions that on one any given play you can really fool them, and there can be a slight hesitation in which it's enough to get a big play put on them. But the run defense is one of the more disappointing aspects. Now, I hate to highlight guys, but I think, the off the line linebackers and safeties are having a really difficult time with their run fits. They're undersized. Raekwon McMillan, who had a really good preseason, is struggling mightily now as the season has come on. Just with his run fits, he's getting washed out of there. He's over pursuing. You're seeing smaller guys playing inside, Marte Mapu, Kyle Duggar, and before that it was Jabril Peppers, and they do the best with what God gave them, but it's those offensive linemen swallow them up, and so there's lanes, there's creases. Keon White is struggling big time against the run. He flashes and he has some nice plays here and there, but at times playing he'll play he's playing D tackle, and I just feel like he's undersized. He kind of gets pushed around there, and so. There's just too many gaps, too many seams, too many leaks, because of the multiple players they have there, partly because of the injury and partly because of the scheme, and just the guys that are just out there aren't qualified to stand up, play in, play out against the run. And so that's kind of what I'm seeing. And then, every now and then, you have, somebody in the secondary who's having a rough game. I've seen Marcus Jones have a rough game. Last week it was Christian Gonzalez. He got picked on, man. They went right at him. They schemed it up so that they got guys open. But he gave up that touchdown, which was a tough cover. to Stephon Diggs. But so there's breakdowns of the secondary. They don't have the right personnel to stop the run. And I think scheme is an issue. And I think sometimes they make life harder on themselves by trying to be versatile, trying to be disguise and fool the other team. And it burns them sometimes. So there's a lot of issues on that defense right now. And back in the day, Karen, when the defenses I played on, if we ever got in a game in which it felt like, you know what, we're just things aren't going right, we had an idea of how we wanted to stop it and it's not working, we always could fall back on 34 cover two, base 34 cover two. Four linebackers, three defensive linemen, and then four defensive backs, and we could play that against three tight ends. We could play against 21 personnel, 11 personnel, 14. You know, we could play against anything. We could play against 10 personnel. We could play against four wide, and everybody knew what to do and how to play it, and so it would calm us down. And then we could then slowly go back to playing more nickel fronts, more dime fronts, more other types of things. But right now, the Patriots defense doesn't have one thing, one personnel group, or one front and coverage that they excel at that they can go to when things get hairy. And that's, to me, one of the more concerning parts of this defense.
I've heard people say, well, this is where they miss Bill Belichick the most. That might be a little too simplistic. For mine, for me anyway, is it, how does he factor in, if at all?
Look, I mean, I thought Bill, the last few years, his just his the quality of his coaching and scheming and in-game management. It was, I mean, I don't know. I just look at the records of the last several years. But really, even though the defenses maybe were performing halfway decent, they weren't playing high level competition and really good quarterbacks. I don't think it's the exit of Bill Belichick is the reason. I think it's all those other things. Bill tried to be multiple. He tried to be versatile. He had a lot of the same issues that this current staff is having. And so I'm not I wouldn't say, that now that Bill's gone, it's the reason that the defense is struggling. There were already a lot of issues on this defense when Bill was even here.
Two final questions. How do you think Gerard's doing, rookie head coach?
I think he's obviously, I think he's struggling a little bit because I think that and the one thing, and it kills me to say this because I'm a fan of Drew. I've only met him once, but he's a likable guy and I see what he's trying. He seems like a good guy and he wants to do well. What I don't see is a clear vision from him. I don't see a guy who's, this is my system, this is what I want, and we're going to do it this way. Delegating is fine, but it really should be, you should be delegating to people that understand what it is your vision. It's not their vision, it's your vision. And I feel like he delegates the guys that have their own kind of way of doing it and how they want to do it. Well, that's when you have everybody, when you delegate all this power and they're doing it their way, then it kind of looks like it does now. And I just think that's kind of an issue. And obviously just I feel bad for him because when you're 1-5 in this market, you're going to get hard questions. They're going to come at you with pointed questions. And if you don't kind of think about your answers and how you want to answer a certain question and anticipate what the reaction is going to be and what's going to be asked of you in these press conferences, you can say things that are going to be contradictory and you're going to talk in circles, and then that's going to make you an even bigger target. And I feel like that's what's going on right now. He's kind of had different messages on different topics throughout the summer and fall. And it's creating, it's making life a little bit more difficult for him than I think it needs to be. And so that's kind of unfortunate. So those are a couple of things that I've noticed from him that I feel like he's got to figure out. He's got to get a clear vision. He's got to, I think, kind of have a hand in, some of the more more of the in-game kind of decisions and not just delegate that. Because at the end of the day, it's going to be his ass on the line as well as those coaches. I mean, those coaches will probably go before him, but ultimately, this is it's his name as on the head seat kind of mantle, and he's got to, I think he's got to take kind of control more of what's going on as opposed to just trusting his guys to do what he thinks right.
Knowing him, I have a feeling he will self-scout himself and hopefully learn, from the mistakes he's made along the way. Looking ahead, they play Jacksonville in London on Sunday. Coming off a game where, you had a quarterback emerge, you still lost by 20 points. What would you like to see against the Jaguars for this
I'd
team?
like to see a team that's more bought in. I'd like to see a team that's more focused, a team that is rallying around their quarterback, and a team that's playing smarter than it's been playing all season long. I mean, this team has gotten progressively worse as the season's gone on. I mean, we all thought after week two, Karen, and they sat 1-1, like, hey, they might have something here. This team's trending in the right direction. And we've seen it go down, down, down. That's not how it's supposed to work. It's supposed to, obviously success is not linear. You're going to have ups and downs, but it has gone straight down since the start of the season. And that's not what you want to see. You want to see, improvement trending upward in all phases. And so that's what I want to see. I want to see a team that it rallies around their quarterback. I want to see a team that's elevated by their quarterback. I want to see smarter coaching. I want to see better game plans, better execution, and the penalties they got to knock off. And so you're hoping that Drake Maye starting now puts guys in a little bit more hyper focus, a little bit more attention to detail, and kind of eliminate some of the sloppy play and sloppy penalties that you're seeing. That's what I'd like to see. Starting this Sunday morning with this game in London is those types of things.
Terrific. Well, we'll know soon enough. And as I said, at least there's a little more curiosity about them because you want to see Drake. You want to see how much better he becomes week to week to week, what more he can produce from the offense week to week to week. So at least they have that going for them. Not much
That's
more.
the hook, though. It's like, okay, and look, I'm all about winning. I want to win. But I think we all see this as probably a lost season. Can they win 9 out of their next 10? Sure, that would be great. I don't expect it, but I'd like to see just an overall improvement from where they started, and the quarterback develop, as the season goes on, and that you hope that by him developing and getting better, that just makes everyone else play better and have the same effect on everyone else. So that's the hope for this season. And I can see, I would think the way you think is just like a lot of people. I'm going to be curious to see more of, hey, what do we got in this kid? Let's see some more exciting action on offense, and not worry as much about the score. I know the players care about that, and they should. That's really a bottom line. But I think from where you and I sit, and from a fan's perspective, that's probably the key element that we're going to be excited to see as the season goes on.
Thanks, Ted. You can listen to Ted every morning on the Rich Sherton Lieb Show on WZLX. You can see him on NBC Sports Boston quite often after games and doing the breakdown.
Breakdown, Karen, every Monday night at 6 o'clock with Phil Perry.
Phil
It's a
Perry,
show.
excellent show. I recommend, highly
Thank you.
recommend. But anyway, thanks, Ted. It was great having you on again.
Karen, it's my pleasure. You call anytime. It's always good chopping it up with you and talking some ball. I appreciate it, and good to see you.